Oh, thank you very much, Chairperson and colleagues. Thank you very much, Chairperson, colleagues, and then all protocols, of course, observed. I was asked to speak on regional integration, but I thought that maybe I should, I was provoked by our sister from, the honorable member from Malawi, maybe to talk rather about my personal experience. Because I think that sometimes we are theoretical about this thing and it doesn't make sense sometimes. I come from Soweto, in a part of Soweto called Tladi. And when we were growing up as young people in South Africa, we had to deal with two issues. Race, which was our encounter with the apartheid system, and in the townships and everywhere in South Africa as a black person, we had to deal with the reality of ethnicity. Those were our big problems, race and ethnicity. In township where I grew up in a part, it was only for the Sotho speakers. And then there was a part which was supposed to be for the Shangaan. Then there was a part which was supposed to be for the Zulu, etc. And then you had a colored part. Then you had the Indians that side. And then the whites were in town. This way where you were working. And this is how I grew up. And I grew up, and then I was in my area, we were also supporting Orlando Pirates. So if today, the very same people who were attacking the Malawians, because Malawians were affected, you take to them, there used to be a Malawian soccer player here who was very famous. You go with him there. They'll be cheering at him, they won't attack him. Then you ask yourself, why these people, when they see a Malawian who's coming as a competitor on the shop floor, working in the gardens, because that's what a lot of Malawians do, they work in the gardens and so on, they attack him. But when he comes as a player for Orlando Pirates, they even put up his posters on the walls. So it's a complex that our minister was trying to explain. And then come 1994, up to then we're dealing with race, ethnicity, and you can say even gender and so on. Even the ANC, this is how we had conceptualized our notion of the National Democratic Revolution on race, class, and gender. Then after 1994 comes in a new phenomenon that we had not been ready to deal with, the so-called foreigner. In my township then, what happens is that I no longer stay there. There is a shop where we used to buy fat cakes and so on and so on. And then I get there, and then when you approach normally a store where they sell fat cakes and chips, you can smell. It's very nice, it's attractive. But the smell is different. Then I ask, what happened? They say, no, it's now owned by a Somalian. This is the shop that in our neighborhood we grew up in, and the owners were local tycoons. Now the owners have disappeared. What the Somalians do, and this is what Vas was talking about, they come to a shop owner. They say to him, how much money you make a month? You say, no, I make 20,000 rand. He says, I'll give you 30,000. Ah, you will, yes. And you lease the shop to him. He's not registered and he starts trading. And then you go and then you can do something else. You get your 30,000. But the Somalians are very good traders. What they do, instead of selling you a packet of sugar, they give you the option, of course, of still buying it as a packet, but you can also buy it in cups. And then they also do something else. They then introduce a credit system in the area. For people who get their money at the end of the month, you can, during the course of the month, especially the pensioners, you can come and get advance. But they then extend the service they offer. They visit the old ladies, they go and deliver food, and then the old ladies, they deliver food there. And then they also go to, it's something that you can undermine, but it's a factor that when we think about these things, a lot of housewives are at home, the husbands are at home, they also deliver food. And in some instances, they then extend their services to other zones. and what happens is that, and this is a reality, I'm not making this, when we talk about this, I want to give the members a sense of a revolution that has happened in the townships. And then, if just to illustrate, if you call this Somali Abdul, he's a Muslim, he doesn't drink, he doesn't go to local taverns, he's working, he only employs Somalians, they all sleep in the shop, They don't integrate. They don't even speak local languages. Now he's the local tycoon. He has taken over the shop with the symbolism it represents in the area. He also goes to this thing, and guys are sitting in the shops, are saying, Abdul, is this with my wife, and this and this. And these are real issues. It's not. Now Abdul feels unsafe. He starts carrying a gun. So you go into these areas, you find the Somalis, they have taken over the local shops. They also bear arms publicly. And it generates resentment. So if you look at how these incidents of attacks and so on always happen, there is a gun and there is a shop. And then there are laborers in there, even in 2008. So that's why I agree with Bayo that maybe we need to do an ethnographic study of what is happening in the townships, because these things are not happening in the suburbs and so on. And the treatment you get at the airports and so on, of course, it's our immigration officials, but I also get it when I go to Nigeria, to Cote d'Ivoire, because I'm a South African. I get shabbily treated, shabbily, and so on, and so on, and so on. But that's part of it. But the point is that the townships since 1994 have undergone a significant transformation, and they have come into real encounter with the foreigner. And I think it's one thing that we have managed very well. We have not managed very well as a country. And that's where the challenge, and this is what this thing is telling us about. And then the second area I wanted to talk about, actually I was going to talk about regional integration and take another angle, but I've diverted a bit. It's when I was asked to talk about the free movement of people. Of course, people come, visitors, asylum seekers, the minister has spoken to that, for work, to reside. And South Africa is both a sending country and a receiving country. But we are also a transit country. It's a category that I think my colleague from the HRC will agree with. South Africa is a sending country. A lot of some professionals, they go to the Gulf. Not even, you could say, especially to work in the airline industry and so on, you find a lot of them in the Gulf area. And then we also export some professionals, especially in the medical area, to the Americas, Canada. A lot of people actually graduates of the UCT Medical School, they emigrate. But we also receive different categories of people. You find, of course, professionals who come and live here, investors and so on and so on. But you also find asylum seekers, you also find the people in the lower skills-based category who go and compete at the low level for jobs in the restaurants, for gardens, for various domestic services. And that's where the problem that the Premier was talking about occurs. But the discussions in the region around free movement of people tend to be very difficult, and they are a challenge. And one of the difficulties is, of course, the unequal development of the region, where some parts of the region, they think that, and perhaps it's not true, that if they open up the gates, that they are going to be inundated. And I saw during the World Cup, we had a visa arrangement. We thought people were going to inundate, but it didn't happen. People came, watched the soccer match, and left. But there is still a view among some of our people in structures of the state to think that if South Africa moved fast in opening up the areas, that South Africa is going to be inundated because of the unequal development of the region. And I want to make an example with how I see negotiations or discussions in SADC happening and the politics of SADC. It's much easier in SADC to discuss intervention in Lesotho. We are all united. We intervene. We are very forceful. We are very strong. It's easier in SADC to say Nkosazana Dlamini Zuma will be our candidate. We lobby, we move. But when we start discussing trade and industrialization, it becomes very, very difficult. I've heard in recent meetings even ministers of certain countries using vulgar language to refer to South Africa. Language that in some people may qualify as insults. But that's how heated this matter is in the region. And I'm just trying to say to honorable members, I think it's one of the big issues that maybe you as parliamentarians can help member states deal with these difficult discussions of integration. There are key issues there. One is the establishment of the SADC Development Fund. Discussions are very difficult there. And then we've got an integration task team of ministers of trade and what. If you go into those discussions, they talk about industrialization. The regional strategy and discussion and discourse and conversation on industrialization in the region is not an easy one. We have had a summit, of course, already in Zimbabwe, but that summit just touched we must still deal with those issues, and they are not easy issues because of the unequal development of the region. It's not very easy. Like, for example, South Africa's argument on trade, on industrialization, is that we must, I'm ready to open up to Malawi's products. And Malawi says, no, you must be ready to open up for products from that come from Malawi, whether they were manufactured in Malawi or not. So I remember at night there it was a big discussion, because countries still that, no, we are entitled, we can get. So what did Chinese do? They come and base in a country, and then they do a bit of packaging, and then they want that to go tariff-free into the South African market. And South Africa feels morally obliged to say, no, because I am exporting to Malawi, then Malawi's goods must also come into our country. So, but the question is that, what sort of goods? In what stage are these goods from China coming through another? So what I'm trying to say is, a real discussion. It's not an easy discussion. It's a difficult discussion, but we must confront it. So it's an outstanding issue of how we industrialize our region, and then also the outstanding issues around the SADC Development Fund, which is provided for, I think, in the SADC Treaty. These are very difficult discussions. So even ourselves here, now we must add the third difficult issue, the free movement of people. So I'm just trying to say that maybe you'll soon be a parliamentary structure of SADC, and you can assist us to deal with these three issues. And then very quickly, just to say that the security issues around the free movement of people, we mustn't undermine. South Africa has been used as a transit. We know that some of the elements that were involved in very horrible acts of terrorism in Nairobi, in Kenya, some of them actually went to Kenya from South Africa. So the issues of security and the movement of some of these elements, I think it makes the discussion around free movement of people very difficult. And then, of course, issues of human trafficking and issues of infrastructure, and then, of course, the stereotypes. So I just want to say, I was going to talk about other issues around the regional integration in the legislative sector, but I can leave that for the other time. But what I'm trying to say, the point I wanted to make is to say that during our struggle, we were dealing with the national question, expressed in terms of race, ethnicity, and to a certain extent, gender. But since 1994, South Africa is confronted with a new reality of the foreigner who's a friend and a Pan-African brother and so on and so on. And clearly, South Africa is going through that phase, and people should allow South Africa to, because we'll overcome it and integrate it and master how to deal with it. So it's a challenge. I wouldn't say it's a crisis, it's a challenge, because some of us are young, we'll still deal with it in the next few years. Thank you very much.